After successfully completing this lesson, you should be familiar with the procedures to follow during tank cleaning. This chapter will also alert you to the effects of seawater, chlorine, and acids on stainless steel. To gain maximum benefit from this lesson, you should successfully have completed the previous lessons. This lesson explains how to clean the tank, pump, and lines. The practical section consists of two parts. First, there is a demonstration of the procedures. This is followed by an interactive guided walkthrough of the same procedures. Proper cleaning of the cargo tank, the pump, and associated lines is extremely important if the required carriage standards are to be met. On parcel chemical tankers in particular, a sound knowledge of the cleaning requirements for the wide range of products carried on such vessels is also needed if damage to the tank lining and the stainless steel pump and piping is to be avoided. On oil tankers, cleaning is a more standardized procedure, but care must still be taken to protect the tank and its fittings. Stainless steel, particularly the grades found on older vessels, is susceptible to damage from salt water, chlorine or bleach, and acids if improperly handled. Therefore, stainless steel tank linings, pumps and lines are all at risk. For preference, cleaning should be carried out only with fresh water, thereby avoiding the risks from salt water altogether. However, only in recent years have freshwater generators become efficient enough to make sufficient quantities of good quality water at a rate that will keep pace with the average cleaning program. Storage may be an option, but only when a supply, adequate tank capacity, and indeed dead weight are available. In addition, freshwater must be used promptly, as quality will deteriorate over time, especially if there is no circulation facility within the tank. It is more common to wash with salt water, in which case it should be taken in an open seaway to avoid contamination from impurities. Similarly, take care to ensure that the seawater inlet being used is well clear of any engine room outlets. Thorough flushing with fresh water will be necessary afterwards to remove all traces of salt. Bleach is sometimes employed to address problems of residual color associated with certain chemical cargoes and dyed gasoline products, or to remove residual odor. Be aware, however, that bleach is extremely aggressive towards stainless steel and must be diluted and applied only according to the procedures outlined in the vessel's operations manuals and supplier's guidelines. Acids, likewise, are extremely aggressive. Once in contact with water, the temperature rises rapidly, and the combination of increasing temperature and reducing concentration greatly increases the corrosion levels. Sulfuric acid is held to be the most dangerous of the regularly carried acids in this respect. This, of course, poses potential problems during cleaning. But, when properly handled, the risks are brought within acceptable and manageable levels. Cleaning of tanks that previously contained sulfuric acid should be carried out as soon as practicable after discharge. If this is not possible, the tanks must be kept dry to avoid a chemical reaction between the acid residues and any condensation. This may involve the application of a nitrogen blanket. Cleaning of sulfuric acid residues should always, wherever possible, be carried out with fresh water. The chlorides in salt water greatly increase the corrosivity of diluted acid, and the risk of damage is much increased. In the event that the supply of fresh water is limited, then salt water can be used initially, but only under strictly controlled conditions. It is essential to keep sulfuric acid cargo residues to an absolute minimum, and, once cleaning commences, to be able to deliver large quantities of water, flushing all surfaces as quickly as possible. The dangerous concentration range is generally between 80% and 20%, and it is essential to pass through this dangerous bracket as quickly as possible. In this way, the acid is rapidly diluted, the temperature rise is quickly countered, and the risk of corrosion is progressively reduced. For the first few minutes, the wash water should be allowed to dilute the acid lying in the sump, but thereafter, the accumulated washing water must be continuously pumped away. If salt water is used, then thorough rinsing of the tank, all pipes and fittings with fresh water must follow. Periodic testing of the washing water as it is being pumped out from the tank will indicate whether all traces of acid have been removed. Litmus paper, which indicates the pH value by the color it turns after being dipped in the water, can be used for this purpose. Phosphoric acid can vary greatly in quality, and besides introducing unknown and potentially aggressive impurities from the core material, substantial quantities of sediment may be encountered. This takes the form of a thick, abrasive paste, which can grind into moving parts. Pump seals in particular will suffer from continued exposure to phosphoric acid sediment. Purging results should be carefully scrutinized when carrying phosphoric acid, and any problems detected should be investigated and corrected at the earliest opportunity. Isocyanates, such as toluene diisocyanate, or TDI, and diphenylmethane diisocyanate, or MDI, solidify and generate large volumes of gas when in contact with water. Traditionally, such products are cleaned first by recirculation with a chlorinated solvent or water-free gas oil, which break down the chemical structure of the product. More recently, maintenance of a nitrogen blanket throughout the cleaning process has allowed water cleaning to be used, but there is no margin for error in this technique. Any isocyanate residues that have solidified are extremely difficult to remove, and prevention is definitely better than cure with these products. It is essential to purge all moisture out of pumps, pipes, tank cleaning machines, etc. prior to loading. This is normally done during the pre-purging of the cargo tank itself. The cofferdam of the Framo pump is also filled with a product called dioctylphthalate, or DOP, as a final preventative barrier against the ingress of cargo. This technique is explained in more depth in the next chapter. Latex is a product like no other, as those who have carried it will freely testify. Care must be taken to run cargo pumps in a controlled manner during discharge, as if the pump cavitates, that is, bubbles form and collapse around the impeller, creating a partial vacuum around the blades and causing the pump to surge. Heat is generated and the latex liquid will rapidly solidify, effectively encasing the pump in a rubber plug and seizing the impeller. The cofferdam is filled with fresh water when carrying latex and circulated using a header tank or reservoir drum with a small portable pump. Visual monitoring of the water will indicate if latex is penetrating to the cofferdam. The water also helps to keep the pump cool. This technique is explained in the next chapter. Some vessels are supplied with special portable latex pumps for discharging such cargoes. The list of products that require special handling and cleaning procedures is large and still growing, particularly for chemical tankers. In all cases, the company's operational manuals and the product safety data sheets must always be consulted. While the discussions so far in this chapter have mainly been concerned with potential damage to stainless steel tank linings and fittings, there is of course a risk to health with many of the products. The appropriate personal protective equipment must always be used, and proper monitoring of tank atmospheres must be conducted in compliance with the company's procedures. All personnel involved in the cleaning program must be briefed prior to commencement, and material safety data sheets must be posted. This chapter focuses on the operation of the Framo submerged deep well cargo pump during tank cleaning. It does not describe crude oil washing techniques, nor does it indicate how atmosphere control within a cargo tank, such as through the introduction and monitoring of inert gas, is integrated into the overall cleaning operation. The applicable safety management system manuals and manufacturer's guidelines should be consulted for the appropriate information on these aspects. As we have already seen, cleaning with good quality fresh water would avoid many problems, but few vessels are fortunate enough to be fitted with the equipment to do so. It is still more common to clean with seawater, flushing down afterwards with fresh water. The example we are going to use in this chapter follows this method. The following should always, where possible, be observed. For preference, seawater used in tank cleaning should not be heated above 60 degrees Celsius, because it becomes increasingly aggressive at such higher temperatures. If temperatures in excess of this are required, for example to remove residues of a product with a high melting point, such washing should be for a limited duration. Stored cleaning water will deteriorate over time. To an extent, this can be avoided by continuing to refresh the supply with new water or by recirculating. If the supply is heated, recirculation will also help to ensure an even temperature throughout the storage tank. Avoid pH values of below 7. This is rarely tested in routine cleaning, but should be checked if results indicate a problem, or if required by a specific cleaning procedure. Avoid chlorinated water. Evaluate the cleaning program in terms of heating limitations of adjacent cargoes. You will now see a demonstration of the procedure to be followed during the tank cleaning operation. Click on the buttons in numerical order. Ensure that cargo hoses have been correctly rigged to the overboard discharge lines or to the slop tank, in compliance with the company's operating procedures and the current tank cleaning plan. Verify that the correct tank cleaning machines have been connected to the cleaning water deck supply line. If applicable, ensure the tank cleaning machine controllers have been correctly programmed. Ensure all cargo line and tank cleaning valves are correctly set. Start the tank cleaning pump and increase output to the required delivery pressure. If the wash water is to be delivered at higher than ambient temperature, apply the heating and bring the temperature up to the desired level. The washing system may have a bleed, that is a branch or outlet which passes directly overboard from the washing water line, through which water can be diverted while the temperature is increasing to the required level. It may also be possible to preheat the supply tank if the water is stored. The cleaning program may also require water to be initially delivered at ambient temperature, only later increasing to a higher level. Start and run the cargo pump, adjusting the flow so that it removes the accumulated wash water at the same rate as it is delivered by the tank cleaning machines. In other words, the sump must be more or less empty during the cleaning operation, but the pump must not be racing. Monitoring the hydraulic pressure gauge for the pump concerned or simply listening to the sound of the pump will assist in determining if the correct level has been set. To clean the stripping lines, open the stripping valve, close the cargo pump discharge valve, and run the pump at approximately 110 bar hydraulic pressure for around 2 to 3 minutes. If a cargo line stripping system is fitted, the stripping valve at the manifold must be opened. This procedure should be repeated several times during the cleaning operation, as the residues are removed and the wash water becomes progressively cleaner. Cleaning of the drop line is done by opening the drop line valve, closing the manifold valve, and circulating the cleaning water for 2 to 3 minutes. This procedure should also be repeated several times during the cleaning operation. When cleaning has been in progress for some time, all drain valves at the low points on the cargo lines should be flushed by opening and closing the valve several times. It is essential that this is done, rather than just cracking the valve open and leaving it, in order that the valve surfaces are all thoroughly cleaned. Drain plugs under valves should also be removed, so that residues in the bottom of the casing are rinsed away. If necessary, make arrangement to collect or divert flushed wash water. Approximately halfway through the cleaning operation, stop the pump temporarily and allow the water to build up in the bottom of the tank to a depth of 5 to 10 centimeters. Then resume, operating the pump at 110 bar hydraulic pressure for 3 to 5 minutes. After this, increase the pump speed up to the maximum and run until the pump loses suction, at which time reduce again. This will ensure that the wear rings, seal rings, and pump casing and internal components are properly cleaned. Complete the washing operation, continuing to flush the valves and lines as recommended. Once the saltwater washing cycle is completed and a satisfactory level of cleanliness achieved, flush the tank, pump, and associated piping thoroughly with fresh water. At the end of cleaning, water remaining in the sump and lines is to be stripped as soon as possible, as described in the previous chapter. A small amount of fresh water left lying in a sump will become stagnant over time and can stain or damage the tank lining. Cargo lines too should be drained and ventilated. This completes the demonstration of the procedure to be followed during the tank cleaning operation. Steam is sometimes injected directly to a tank as part of the cleaning process. The cargo pump seals can be damaged if exposed to live steam, and it should therefore not be applied for more than 10 minutes. Always purge the pump cofferdam before steaming a tank to avoid any reaction with cargo which might be in the cofferdam. Care should be taken with any stored slops for a number of reasons. Slops containing salt water should never be stored in stainless steel tanks due to the aggressive nature of the chlorides in the water. Slops with more than 10% acid residue content should not be stored in stainless steel tanks due to the corrosive nature of such a mixture. Slops containing alkaline residues, such as from caustic soda solution, should not be stored in zinc-coated tanks. Reactivity between different sets of tank washings should be carefully researched before mixing in the same tank. consideration should be given to later disposal of slops. Commercial requirements may dictate that certain chemicals cannot be included in a slop mixture landed to shore. It may be necessary to heat slops to dissolve solidified residues, and it must be confirmed that such heating can be delivered to the selected slop tank. If slops are to be disposed of at sea, it must be confirmed that the vessel will at all times be capable of complying with the requirements of MARPOL. Good practice dictates that slop storage time is anyway to be minimized. Slops should be disposed of as soon as operationally and legally possible.